Good afternoon. We welcome you to St. Anne's Catholic Church, and especially to any visitors or newcomers to our parish. We welcome you to our community. Today is the 17th Sunday of Ordinary Time. It's also the vigil of the Feast of St. Anne, patroness of our parish. The announcements for this week are: thank you to all who have returned their Catholic annual P.O. pledge envelope. It is not too late to return your pledge envelope if you haven't already done so. The new Mass schedules are printed in the parish bulletin. Daily Mass schedule is every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday at 8 a.m. Please take the bulletin for more information. The Mass today is being celebrated by Father Pat. In today's reading, we learn the following lesson. The person with true wisdom, like Solomon, will seek the reign of God and the treasure it above, and treasure it above all else. It is more precious than gold. Thus one becomes conformed to the image of Christ the Son. Please join me in praying the St. Michael prayer. This prayer is being taught. Is being said by the right for the right to life, as taught by our Catholic faith. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him with humbly praise. And do thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl about the world for the ruin of souls. Just a reminder to turn off all your cell phones during Mass. Now please rise and take a moment to greet your fellow parishioners.
Jesus, you brought us the treasure of the Father's love. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, by your death, you have won for us the treasure of forgiveness and life. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have left us in the Eucharist the treasure of your presence and your strength. bestow in abundance your mercy upon us. Grant that, with you as our ruler and guide, we may use the good things that pass, such a way as to hold fast, even now, to those that endure. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. The Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night. God said, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Solomon answered, "O Lord my God, you have made me your servant king to succeed my father David. But I am mere youth, not knowing at all how to act. I serve you in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a people too vast that it cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding heart to judge your people and to distinguish right from wrong. For who is able to cover this vast people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon made this request. So God said to him, "Because you have asked for this, not for a long life for yourself, nor for riches, nor for the life of your enemies, but for understanding, so that you may know what is right, I do as you requested. I give you a heart too wise in understanding, that there has never been anyone like you up to now. And after you, there will come no one to equal you." The word of the Lord. Responsorial Psalm. Lord, I love your commands. I have said, O Lord, that my heart is to keep your word. The law of your mouth is to me more precious than thousands of gold and silver pieces. Lord, I love your command. Let your kindness comfort me according to your promise to your servant. Let your compassion come to me that I may live, for your love in my life. Lord, I love your commands. For I love your commands more than gold, however fine, for in all your precepts to go forward. Every false way I hate. Lord, I love your commands. Wonderful are your decrees, therefore I observe them. The revelation of your words sheds light, giving understanding to the simples. Lord, I love your commands. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we know that all things work for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, so that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure buried in a field, which a person finds and hides again, and out of joy goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. When he finds a pearl of great price, he goes, sells all that he has, and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea, which collects fish of every kind. When it is full, they haul it ashore and sit down to put what is good into buckets, and what is bad they throw away. Thus it will be at the end of the age. The angels will go out and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Do you understand all these things?" They answered, "Yes." And he replied, "Then every scribe who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household, brings from his storeroom both the new and the old." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Imagine that God sent an angel to you who said, "Ask for whatever you want, and God will give it to you." What would you ask for? Perhaps in this time of the COVID-19 epidemic, you might ask for help for you and your family. You might ask for economic security in these unsettled times. Some might ask for peace, for racial justice, for care for the environment. In the first reading, God appeared to Solomon and told him, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Solomon had just inherited the kingdom of his father, King David. David had conquered all the enemies of his land. He renewed the covenant that was made originally up Mount Sinai, binding the people to God. The kingdom enjoyed peace and prosperity. Solomon answered God, saying, "I am a mere youth, not knowing how to act." That might be the prayer of many people today. Think of those that graduated from high school and are wondering, should they enroll in college or technical school? What steps should they take? Will they be able to find work? And parents with young children who face an uncertain schedule, the schools try to decide on online classes or in-classroom learning. Healthcare workers, service dog workers, work situations are constantly changing. We do not know what we are doing today will change tomorrow, or how best to plan for the future. The tension of uncertainty is a source of stress, causing arguments and divisions in families. We need the gift of wisdom to respond to all these changes, these uncertainties, new ways of doing ordinary things. Listen to Solomon's answer as he continued to speak to God. We can make his prayer our own. Solomon prayed, "Lord, give your servant, therefore, an understanding heart." Solomon was asking for wisdom and understanding to make good decisions for himself and for his kingdom. A person who has wisdom knows how to cope with the situations of life, whether they bring joy and success or difficulties and struggles. In today's Gospel, Jesus tells two parables about the importance of wisdom in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven. In the first parable, Jesus compares entering the kingdom to a person who stumbles across a treasure in a field. It's helpful to remember that ordinary people in those days didn't have access to banks. If they had valuables, the safest way to guard them was to bury them in the ground. But war, violence, perhaps a coming disaster,
appoint a course of family to suddenly leave. And then they might not be able to return. Perhaps they might die, betrayed with a name hidden until someone found it. In the parable, a man found the treasure. He sells all that he has to buy the field and get the treasure. But what is the meaning? How are we to interpret the parable? When we really discover Jesus and his vision of life, the good news of God's love and God's care for us, everything else becomes secondary. St. Paul found the buried treasure of Jesus, and he would write, I count everything as loss because of the unsurpassing joy of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. St. Paul realized that his friendship with Jesus and accepting his way of life was the most precious thing in the world, a great treasure. And in a way, we might say he sold everything, left everything, that he might enjoy that treasure, share that treasure with others. The second parable has a similar message. A merchant is looking for a really beautiful, perfect pearl. When he finds it, he sells everything he has to acquire it. The pearl symbolizes his relationship with Jesus. It is more valuable than all the possessions that he had, and he eagerly sells them in order to obtain the pearl. There's a difference in these two parables, though. In the first, the man is not looking for a buried treasure. Perhaps he's walking through the field and he notices something shining in the dirt. Or perhaps it was a day laborer plowing the orange field, and suddenly the pile turns up coins, parts of his work. Jesus, the real meaning of life, comes to him somewhat unexpectedly. But he responds to this surprise wholeheartedly. He sells all he has to buy the field. Many people describe their conversion to Jesus as happening in unexpected ways. The gospel urges us to be ready whenever, however, Jesus comes into our lives. We know that that happened for St. Paul, whom I just mentioned, but Francis of Assisi, St. Augustine, had similar experiences finding the treasure of Jesus somewhat unexpectedly. In the second parable, it's different, because the merchant has been looking for this perfect pearl for a long time. And as soon as he found it, he sold all and possessed it. Many search for a deep personal relationship with the Lord for a long time. They might enjoy many gifts that God gives them. But pearls and precious stones are not that perfect pearls yet. God is with them, and he guides them in their journey and their search. You might say, they search with God at their side. In the first parable, the finding of the treasure was an unexpected surprise. Yet it didn't come free. The person had to decide to sell all that he had to buy the field. The gift of wisdom led him to make a good decision. It was worth selling everything for paying the treasure. Wisdom helps us to put things into perspective. Wisdom guides us to give up ourselves in order to receive an unimaginable treasure of peace and joy, entering into the kingdom, even now, and then for all eternity. In the second parable, the merchant finds the perfect pearl after a long search. He has enjoyed pearls and precious stones, and now he finds this really exquisite pearl and sells everything to possess it. He also does so with joy in his heart. This is the wisdom to sacrifice all to possess the treasure of the pearl, to enter into that deep, profound relationship with the Lord. The two parables call for total commitment and sacrifice as we would welcome Jesus into our lives, and the wisdom that we might make the right decisions as we welcome the Lord. The third parable, fish, reminds us that in the church there are saints and sinners. Jesus came to call sinners into his kingdom. He would lead us to the treasure and to search for that perfect pearl. And in that search, we might draw closer and closer to him. We might say, in the net, we are saints and sinners, good fish and bad fish. The Lord calls us to be compassionate and understanding toward one another. We have to use this time wisely, attentive to the treasures and pearls, so that we grow in faith and commitment with the Lord. And at the same time, we are helping one another in this great commitment of God's face. We are not to think just of ourselves. The parables remind us of wisdom that leads to welcoming a deep relationship with Jesus and to one another. Like Solomon, we pray for practical wisdom to make decisions every day and follow the Lord's word, to use our time, our energy, our resources in a wise way. Perhaps there have been times when we have missed the treasure that God has placed before us. We didn't notice the goal is worth. We were rushing on to the next thing on our agenda. Or we saw the perfect pearl, but decided, I'll come back later for it. The parable invites us to look at Him like everyday events, see God revealing Himself to us, accompanying us. If we might say, life is charged with the surprising presence of God. Now in our liturgy, the Lord comes. We might say in ordinary things, with words, with bread, and wine. And yet He makes those ordinary things special treasures and pearls, signs of His presence as He comes to share His life with us. He comes to renew within us wisdom, that we might welcome and recognize and welcome the treasures of His love and His friendship.
Stand as we make our profession of faith and the last respond highly to these questions of faith. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, was crucified, died, and was buried, rose from the dead, now seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, union of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting?
Amen.
God, the all-powerful Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, has given us birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and forgiven all our sins. May He also keep us near to our Lord and Savior Jesus, who lives forever and ever. Ministry that has been entrusted to us, to the church, is to pray for each and every one of our brothers and sisters, so that we all discover the rich treasure of our faith. So now we pray with trust and confidence in God's generous grace and goodness.
For all who minister in the church, eager to share its lasting treasure, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For wise leaders and brave public servants, working patiently for peace in a violent world, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who work in difficult, unjust conditions, seeking fair pay and a safe environment, let us pray to the Lord. For those who care for the sick and the dying, showing the Lord's love in their daily actions, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the children of this assembly, teaching adults how to trust in God's mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for all those who have done, especially Donna Mitchell and my grandson Zama, that they may enjoy the fullness of God's heavenly glory. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We offer now our personal intentions. For these and other prayers enter in our book of prayer, and those that are held in our hearts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we thank you because in you we have found the treasure that makes our life worth living. Keep us in your love. Guide us to your kingdom, now and forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the offerings which we bring from the abundance of your gifts, that through the powerful working of your grace, these most sacred mysteries may sanctify our present way of life and lead us to eternal gladness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. So with all the angels we praise you, as a joyful celebration, we acclaim,
Holy, 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 Holy Lord, Child of God, heaven and earth are filled with your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, Lord, fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts we pray, by sending down your Spirit above them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, entering willingly into his passion, he took bread, giving thanks and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat it with me. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant,
which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and ministry to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Paul, our Archbishop, his assistant bishop Daniel, and the Savior, and all the clergy, and all the faithful. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. We praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command informed by divine teachings, we dare to say, Our Father, I love you above all things. decided to come up afterwards, so that especially when we send our out, we do that to stay distant between one another.
Listen,
Let us pray. We have consumed, O Lord, this divine sacrament, the perpetual memory, memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift, which he himself gave us with love beyond all telling, may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Today is the last weekend that seminarians met, and Patrick will be with us. So, in the name of the parish, thank you both very, very much for your time.